In this video, I'm going to show you how I rendered this 3D model in a Fran Silvestre Arquitectos style. Fran Silvestre Arquitectos is a firm that has a very distinct style that most of you probably already stumbled upon some of their work. While it's their architecture that has a unique style, it's often these white buildings with minimal elements. Sometimes they look like a paper sheet folded that formed the architecture. And as you can probably tell by all of these reference images, Fran Silvestre is much influenced by Alvaro Siza's work. Now, the visual communication of the studio also has a style in a sense. Both the photography and the renderings often show these clear blue skies, images that have overall more contrast, brighter highlights, and darker and sharper shadows. The building's surrounded by dense vegetation, and the images have more sky area than you often see on typical renderings or architectural photography. I mean, there's much more I could talk about here, but all of this context to say that it can be an interesting rendering exercise, a simple 3D model to practice the core skills of architectural visualization. Let me show you how I got to these four results here, and you can get the 3D model in SketchUp for free in the link in the video description to practice as well, or support us and get all of the files, including the PSDs and the D5 files, to check everything in detail. Sounds good? Let's begin. The 3D model was done here in SketchUp, and I used a few of Fran Silvestre's buildings as inspiration and designed something a little bit different, but that resembled the paper folded type of design. And I'm not claiming here that it's easy to design something like this with all of the elegance that Fran Silvestre's studio does. This was purely for a rendering exercise and something that you can do too. It all started with some basic sketches, but overall you can see how simple, in a sense, the 3D model is, right? Everything is going to be done pretty much in the render engine, and I'm using here D5 render. You can get to these results with so many other engines. It's just the core aspects of this type of image that you need to pay attention to. Now, here in 3D, I just ensured that the materials were applied, and then the basic furniture was also in place. In terms of materials, the important ones are obviously the wall material, then a flooring one, and by looking at the references, I guess it's often travertine, then glass, and a few others. So let me open a new D5 file and connect it with the Live Sync plugin, and we'll go from there. So first things first, I need to create the terrain. This is something that could have been done in 3D, or you could even bring this model from BIM, from the site drawing you had, but often these technical terrains can be too flat and a little bit too sharp. So my suggestion is to use it as a base and cover it with the more of a freeform type of terrain tool. And since I'm using here D5, I'm going to use the terrain tool. But again, adapt to your render engine or modeling workflow as needed. The terrain tool is quite simple, just brushes that can bring the terrain up or down, smooth and flatten it. And I find the intensity to be a bit strong, so I often like bigger brushes to start with and then lower the number on the strength a lot. And I gotta say that this is not the most efficient process. It's a bit of a trial and error approach, going up and down to match the original terrain, and also trying to make this look natural without too many weird bumps, but also making sure that it looks uneven to give more complexity and realness to the terrain. So yeah, just take your time when doing this. Use the technical terrain as reference. You can even bring it down a little bit to then model this just above it and make everything connect correctly. Now, this entrance part here underneath the top floor, I'm keeping it visible to have a dirt road access, just as an extra challenge to show you how to integrate existing geometry with the terrain. And while you're doing this, you're building the new terrain, remember to adjust the original geometry as needed to accommodate the new one. So either bringing it all back or just lowering some parts that are becoming visible. And I think the biggest downside of using a terrain tool like this is that it's quite easy for it to sort of leak inside your building like this. In most cases, I was able to resolve it quite easily, but sometimes that might not be the case depending on the project, depending on the type of building you have. So possibly you will have to have a mix between the terrain in your 3D modeling, the more technical terrain that I was talking about, and the terrain tool in your render engine. Or then, if you're using SketchUp, Rhino, or BIM to model the original terrain with more detail, something that from a site drawing that you picked, then just leave what's further away to be done with the terrain tool and try to match it. I consider these two methods. If I had too many leaks inside my model, I'd probably go for this one with the mix between the two. But since I didn't have too many restraints with the terrain on this one, I chose for this method with just using the terrain tool in the render engine. Okay, so after a bit of time, this is what I got trying to adapt the building to the terrain while giving it detail and complexity to make it look natural. I just need to come in here and dial down a little bit of the erosion, but that's about it. And now moving on to the next part, finally vegetation. And I encourage you guys to use some sort of scattering functionality as mentioned. This will save you a ton of time with these more heavy vegetation scenes. I'm using D5, which has a very good scatter tool, but there are other options that you can use even directly in a 3D modeling software. For example, Blender will have it, 3D Max as well, or even directly in SketchUp with a scatter plugin. There are many, many ways to go about this, but I'll do it here in D5 with the scatter tool because then I can use the vegetation library. And there's even a really good trick here using the terrain and the scatter is that you can do a terrain paint function to paint the scatter area. Sounds complicated, but let me show you. So here I'll pick another ground material. It can be anything really, as it's gonna get covered by the vegetation anyway. And for this one, I'll do the tree scatter to begin with, and I'll start adding what's supposed to be the tree scatter around this building. So something like painting a bit here and a bit there, where I want this mess of trees to go. And once you think you're done, and don't worry, you're gonna be able to come back here to refine this later if needed. But once you're done, you can come here to the three dots and choose create scatter area. That's it. This is the sort of functionality that you find in more advanced 3D like Blender and 3ds Max and the respective rendering engines. But here in a software that is made for Archviz, it might be a little bit limiting compared to the other ones. But again, it's made for speed and it's made for Archviz purposes. I really hope that other engines also provide this sort of painting scatter tool. Now, this video is not sponsored or anything. It's just that with the addition of the scatter in the terrain, D5 has been the main engine for me. I still use other engines like Lumion and V-Ray, and there will be other videos about them here on the channel soon. But yeah, the scatter and the terrain are ideal for these type of images. So from here, you treat this as any other scatter object, adding the assets and going through the settings. It's more of like setting up a little bit and looking at the scene or looking at the entire model, going back to the settings, adding a little bit more different vegetation, going through the settings again, going through the density. But one trick that I often like to use is to add a mask. This helps you make this blob, the area that you painted, a bit more natural and not too unrealistically full. So this is the basics of the process, painting in with the terrain tool, creating the scatter areas and adding the vegetation. Then this obviously depends on the environment of the project, but from the references and to give a little bit more complexity, you can use different sizes of plants. Naturally, this would already happen. So we have multiple scatters, multiple sizes of vegetation from trees to bushes, to grass, to weeds, to really make it complex, make it feel more like a natural environment. And if you're doing this manually and not with a scatter, then well, it's going to take a lot more time, but you can also do that. And again, this is not a straightforward process. There's a lot of tweaking and refining, and I don't want to take multiple hours of your time going through this since it's a little bit of the same. The essentials you now know, so I'll skip to the model that is complete in terms of vegetation. By the way, if you're looking to learn D5 render and Photoshop to create amazing renderings and master this workflow, we've got a full course on it. 12 plus hours, 60 plus lessons of in-depth content. And every time D5 releases new updates, like adding new tools and functions, I'm adding lessons to complement the curriculum. Click the link in the video description to learn more about it. Now back to the video to talk about materials. It's super simple. I mean, the work is not here on materials, so I decided to use just the ones that I have purchased in the past from Polygon. A basic wall material so that it's not too basic and just white. Then a travertine tile material that I adjusted to be slightly brighter than it is, just to match the references and match the wall as well. Then a glass material from the D5 library. The water, the same thing, something that's ready to use and I mean, it's gonna look good anyways. And well, the fabric here from the furniture, I decided to do something a little bit different. I used this one here and made the scale super big so that it would show up from the aerial view. It might not be the most realistic, but to be visible in the scenes that I was planning, it worked perfectly. then other materials like the pole one, and well, it doesn't really matter. I think the walls, the glass, and maybe the flooring are gonna make more difference. But to be honest, this type of render is more of the vegetation, the scenes, the lighting, which is something that we're gonna talk about now. So with the model in place, let's look quickly at some references directly from the website and Instagram of Fran Silvestre Arquitectura. And now here on these images, look at the proportions, the framing, the colors. Again, many of the photos and renderings have this saturated blue sky, often clean. The exuberant vegetation is part of this color scheme. That's usually the white, the green, and blue. The camera angles are always part of the storytelling of the image. And this obviously has to do with the photographer, obviously, but you can see that this positioning also happens with the renderings as well. Sometimes there's a very clear symmetry that this is something that you can practice and try to go for. Other images have more of a wide angle lens. Well, I could go on and on here, but take some time if you're doing this exercise and analyze the images, both in the website, but also on Instagram, where they sometimes share projects that are not built yet. Okay, so based on these references, now to create the lighting, like the references. So I started looking at HDRIs that generated harsher shadows. I wasn't too worried about what the sky actually looked like much, because it's hard to get that look from the references straight from the render without some sort of post-processing or compositing, especially with engines that are simpler and more geared towards architectural uses. For this aerial scene, it doesn't matter too much, but alternatively, you could go for a default sun in your render engine. Here in D5, I'm able to pick the exact placement of the sun to fine-tune the type of shadow and the format and shape I actually need. To be honest, for this aerial, I chose the HDRI, but then I wanted to do some scenes from eye level, and for this one, I used the default sun. A scene to show the pool area and the relation of the building to the surroundings. As you can see, the sky here is much more towards the cyan color yet, so this required a little bit of work later in Photoshop. Now, one thing that I didn't talk about with the scatters that I think you might find interesting, especially now that we're talking about scenes, since the scatter is a bit of a random thing, right? The placement of the trees, the scale, and the look that's going to be, which can be a good thing, but not so much, depending if you're trying to recreate an existing site where you're trying to get a specific shape and size, or like the framing of the vegetation with the scene. I mean, then I suggest placing the trees closer to the building, more of a manual process, and leaving what's the back on the background more random and with the scatters. But in any case, since I have everything with the scatter, if you have a setup like this, you can come here to the seed tab and shuffle through it until you find a combination that looks good. So let me go back to what I had. And for the scene aspect ratio, I decided to go with the square. Then as I was looking at the photos on the website, I noticed how some of the projects are on a hill, and photos are taken like from below, creating this very interesting look. So here I tried something like that. I chose a tighter lens for this and cropped the scene a bit so it didn't show the ends of the building. Sort of like giving the idea that there's more of the building to show, and focused more on the layers of this design, of this paper sort of effect. And then why not a night scene as well, since everything is already set up. There's some really powerful night photos on Fran Silvestre's website that we can get inspired from. Just keep in mind that night scenes often require a little bit more post-production to get the exposure levels correct, especially when we're looking at the references and we want to match that. So now onto Photoshop, and I'll walk you through the main things I did here, because I'm not going to be able to show you everything. I definitely took advantage of the AI enhancer, but as always, be careful not to reveal any unwanted glitches or artifacts. You don't want to ruin your image and feel like it was completely generated by AI, so use a mask. For people, I like to use another AI enhancer, one called Crea. There are many options available. This one I just like to use because it's a little bit better with people and with a little bit of motion blur, and in this case, very minimal motion blur because the scene is already too bright to produce longer blurs. But this combination of the AI enhancer and this little bit of blur made the person look really good. Now, depending on the type of image, you know, the type of visualization that I'm doing, I do a folder specifically to add the stuff that I'm fixing. Sometimes it's easier to do this type of stuff here in Photoshop, for me at least. And then to finalize and get the correct look, definitely some camera raw filter. The correct settings depend on the type of image you have, but here I added more contrast with the curve, but also reduced a bit of the clarity and texture. I feel that often renderings nowadays come too crisp and too digitally enhanced, that I feel that reducing a little bit of clarity and texture gives more of a natural result. Especially since we already combining a bunch of effects and even the AI enhancer on top. For this next image here, the work was mostly on the sky replacement. I mean, you don't need to replace the sky, you can just work on the colors. But, well, I decided to add a bit of clouds on the bottom part of the sky, so for me, it was easier just to replace it. And then for this last scene, at least for the day one, I made a selection using the material ID render element and adjusted, refined this selection to only cover this front portion of the building, because I wanted to emphasize the shadow side, as you can see. And the render wasn't giving me that much, and it wasn't really too much about just enhancing the contrast. I wanted to make the shadow side more present on the image. It was mostly that gave me a bit of work. I mean, obviously the sky replacement here as well, but that was kind of easy. You know, the shadow part was more of a tweaking, a refined selection, to be honest. And then the night version of this last scene that looks more different from the base render, as you can see. And that's kind of expected, to be honest. It's hard to get this dramatic look from the base render. At least I prefer to explore a bit more flat than usual and then have this margin to do the post-processing here in Photoshop. It's sort of thinking like you're taking a photo in a raw format or in a more flat format, and then you do the post-processing in Lightroom or like when you do video editing. It's sort of the same thing. You have more margin to go the extra step in adding that contrast and in dialing that dramatic look. And to wrap this up as a last tip to give this more glowy effect that sometimes doesn't come out from the render like that, it's usually hard. Even if you use a bloom effect, it's hard to get something like this. I like to use a hue and saturation adjustment layer set to colorize, and on a brighter yellow color, then with the mask, you can reveal on the window and interior areas, and then you get this look. So that's it. That's the process of creating these four images. If you have any specific questions, I can always answer them in the comments below. And if you've got to this part of the video and are considering learning D5 render or getting better at it, remember that we've got a full course that covers both the D5 part, going into everything that you need to know, tools, features, workflows inside it, but also then Photoshop for the post-production step, well, and even the AI tools that you can use to enhance this process. There's a link in the video description if you want to check it out. The feedback from the students has been amazing, so I'm sure you're going to like it as well. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you like this type of video, and I'll see you in the next one.